I wonder if our evolutionary history, you know, given that the way things evolve, the mechanisms, and correct me if I'm wrong on this, but it seems that the mechanism over 200 million years or what have you, since we evolved from this primordial protoplasm into full-fledged human beings, the mechanism that has driven that has been a lot of competition, and mutation, and death of the species that lost the competition, and the advancement of the species that kind of the survival of the fittest, so to speak, which everybody likes to talk to. That I guess Darwin actually never said, but kind of this survival of the fittest, and that's so genetically encoded in us that when we are confronted by someone who's very different from us, whether it be someone of a different color skin or a different religion or a different culture or a different political party, that it triggers within us this deeply encoded instinct for survival that says, survival of the fittest. I need to either defeat this other or at least subjugate them utterly. And that in some respects, this passage about loving your enemies seems to kind of short circuit that circuitry that's built, kind of encoded within us.
Yeah. It's a curious thing. I think that there is a sense in which that there's a sort of default mode, right? A default mode that we're sort of wired with in part. There's some conversation too about whether or not competition and whatnot really is the default, the only default. That there's, it seems like there's a strong strong tendencies toward altruism and some other things that can help promote healthy groups, really. So I think that too, you'll have to talk with some of your future scientists to get the full details. But I think even that there's some hope for us in that even too. But I think that religion and faith, one of the things that they can really do is help us move to our better natures. Yeah. I think that's all of these listen and be merciful and love your enemies. I think that's the mode out of which we should operate. And it doesn't it doesn't ask you to push those out to be certain or to push that those questions and doubts out of the community, right? It really wraps them into a community. And I think that's the piece that I always get nervous about in faith and science conversations. Once you've been convinced that there is a convergence and a compatibility, not to let that get too easy, and that we really have to live in this sort of messy ambiguity, right? Which is also a very Lenten word, that we have to live in this, the questions and the doubts, and that's all of that is part of really a full and faithful life.
Yeah. That's an interesting point. When Jesus even says, you love your enemies, he actually doesn't say don't have enemies or don't have opponents or people who are opposed to you or that you're opposed to. He just says to love them. And even in that statement, there is a call not to reduce the tensions between us too far or to try to eliminate those, but to bridge those in some way.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think really the goal for us, whether it's the faith and science conversation or whether it's within religious communities, I don't think consensus is necessarily our first best goal. I think some kind of solidarity where we can work together for the common good in ways that don't depend on, getting rid of all of the doubts and questions. I think that's really the healthy way forward.